Jerome, there's so many things out there that are right in your wheelhouse, and one of them is a topic near and dear to my heart that doesn't get much airtime: interest on reserves, IOR. It's now a policy tool that has melted away into the shadows until now. Now, we should have a chart up there, but why is interest on reserves something important, and why is it now being recalibrated?
Well, it's simply being recalibrated now that we're past the financial crisis. We need a normalized policy.
A bit of the ways past.
But more importantly, what we're doing is making small, minuscule steps to that normalization process. IOER, interest on excess reserves, was actually meant to be a floor, not a ceiling rate as it's been for the past few years. And right now, Jay Powell and the rest of the Fed is looking to normalize that and bring that rate down. So what does it mean ultimately for investors?
Wait, let's make this even more plain spoken. Basically, interest on reserves is a nice treat, okay, for those that can get it. Now they're taking away a little of the sugar out of the recipe. Why are they making it less tasty is really what I want to know.
Well, simply, there's less reserves to be had around, so they're trying to price appropriately what it
costs
for a reserve.
So it worked a little too well. That they want put to other areas because it's making the management of monetary policy more difficult.
So think about it this way. They have a tool chest. This is still a tool. It will remain a tool for the foreseeable future. They're just simply making it twist a little tighter to bring risk-free rates a little bit lower. And so for investors, ultimately what they have to think about is they're going to be paid less to sit on the sidelines, a little bit less, only 5 basis points
less. I'll tell you why this bugs me, Jerome, because interest on reserves is just now another area that's being manipulated in rates. Basically, what you're telling me, if you look at it from a more cynical perspective, and those that look at the chart, it's higher than all the market rates. So people in money funds, as they're not paying out as many chocolate chips, are going to get less, which meant they were getting more, which meant it wasn't a market-driven rate.
So the investors who are sitting in money market funds are going to have a little bit more pain on a relative value basis.
And the Fed and the government now have a much bigger presence in money markets to begin with, don't they?
Correct. And there's different
tools. Whenever I have this conversation,
Jerome, this is the important thing.
The next thing that happens is that the problem areas of future crisis always seem to come in areas that aren't market driven. Are money market rates another area I'm going to have to worry about?
Rick, simply put, the Fed is in the volatility management business. As investors, we should also be in the volatility management business. And in doing so, the flat yield curve or the flattening yield curve that you've highlighted so many times is actually a great opportunity set for investors to think about that front end of the yield curve, because those rates are low but moving higher. They need to think about more specifically about where they're de-risking and managing that volatility.
Now, let's go to another area. I love the yield curve conversation. And I've said before that inversions aren't going to mean what they used to mean because there's so many things that have distorted long rates. But people may think it still does. To that end, there's been like 3 basis points between 7s and 10s. Would Jay Powell, who we both really like, would he risk inverting 7s to 10s, which is always a precursor to the entire curve inverting, if he wanted to raise rates? I mean, would he let that stop?
So it's definitely going to be at the forefront of their mind. However, we have to recognize the Fed's changed their protocol at this point in time. 4 rate hikes this year, 3 the next, 1 the following year. And as a result, we have to prepare for those higher rates going forward, insofar as that growth continues. When you forecast a second quarter GDP approximately a 3.7%, that's a pretty powerful metric for them to continue raising rates for the foreseeable future. And for investors, we need to be thinking about that. As we approach the inversion, that's not necessarily a warning bell to go off. In fact, while it's a signal of recession, it's not necessarily a signal of the timing of recession.
I know it's a signal of. There's going to be a whole lot more Fed speak, I think, moving forward in my crystal ball, about inversion of curves and why you shouldn't be too nervous about them. You think that's coming?
I think it's coming, but investors have an easy way to do it and stay de-risked into the front end of the yield curve.
Stay in the front. We agree on that.
Hey there, thanks for checking out CNBC on YouTube. Be sure to subscribe to stay up to date on all of the day's biggest stories. You can also click on any of the videos around me to watch the latest from CNBC. Thanks for watching.